You know, since our secretariat videos did so well, maybe we should do another series on a horse.
Well, how about Seabiscuit? Amazing how we just had these sitting here. It's like we planned it.
Secretariat, Shackleton, and Secretariat.
Seabiscuit!
They both have similar sounding names! Why is it that two of the greatest racehorses in American history have almost identical names?
I don't know.
You do realize that if we continue doing series on a character whose name starts with S, we're going to have to rename our channel the S History Channel. Hello, I'm Charles.
And I'm James.
We love history, and we want to share our love of history with you.
Today, we are beginning a brand new series on the racehorse Seabiscuit.
Yep. And we're doing so because the anniversary of his great match race is coming up this November. And since we have a horse video, we are joined by our in-house horse historian, our sister.
Let's get on with it.
You stole those from my room, didn't you?
Well, you're the one who has all the books on Seabiscuit.
We needed the props.
You stole those from my room, didn't you?
Just like we did with the secretariat pictures.
I should lock my door, shouldn't I?
That would be wise if you don't want us to get stuff for props.
On May 23rd, 1933, a legend was born. But he sure didn't look like it. He was born into a prestigious family. His grandfather being one of the greatest ever known to his sport. His parents, on the other hand, they were absolute disgraces. Who is this legend? This little outcast who captured the heart of America during a very tumultuous time. His name was Seabiscuit.
Seabiscuit's sire was hardtack. No, not the foul food that soldiers ate during the American Civil War and they broke their teeth off of. Although he is named after the soldiers' hard food. And his son, Seabiscuit, is a hardtack on the sea. And hardtack was the most beautiful son of the great man of war. But he completely failed at racing. Great looks, stunk at the track. This was because hardtack had a fiery temper and just would not behave. Seabiscuit's mother was Swing On, who, despite her active name, was a lazy, knobby-kneed mare who was too slow to win a race. And where hardtack was at least a good looker, Seabiscuit was anything but a looker. There was nothing about him that said star. It was only because of his parents' pedigree that Seabiscuit was kept on the farm. In that year's group of foals, Seabiscuit started out as the runty outcast who always ran behind the rest of the other foals. But Seabiscuit was determined and drove forward, working hard at his running and developing stronger leg muscles. And by fall, he was running close at the heels of the best of the crop. However, when Seabiscuit started training in 1935, he was almost ruined.
Seabiscuit's trainer was Sonny Jim Fitzsimmons. He trained many great horses, including Gallant Fox, who'd won the Triple Crown in 1930, and who would have been at that time training the future Triple Crown winner, Omaha. Fitzsimmons had also trained hardtack, which probably made him judge Seabiscuit in a similar light. However, Seabiscuit was one of the few times this great trainer misjudged a horse. Seabiscuit and Fitzsimmons clashed dramatically. Fitzsimmons tried to force Seabiscuit to give him his best, and Seabiscuit was determined not to be forced. The more pressure he was put under, the slower he got. The only time this determination was broken was out of surprise and fright when his jockey was told to use the whip as much as possible to keep him up with another horse. This was because Fitzsimmons thought Seabiscuit would only run under hard punishment. But once the surprise and fright wore off, Seabiscuit was just as determined not to be forced. He was basically discarded from there on out.
Seabiscuit's first race ever was January 19th, 1935. He lost. This convinced Fitzsimmons that he was not worth keeping. So Seabiscuit was entered into a $2,500 claiming race.
Wait. I think people are gonna wanna understand what is a claiming race. Because unless you know anything about horses, a claiming race does not make sense.
Okay, a claiming race is a race where any horse that is currently being run is technically for sale, even if the owner really doesn't want the horse to be sold. But anybody can come in and claim the horse, pay the price that is on that horse, and purchase it.
But this is before the race is run, so this can't be like, ooh, that guy just won the race, I want him.
Yes, you claim the, at least today. Things may have been a little bit different back then, I'm not 100% sure. Research is hard to find on some of this stuff way back in the 1930s. But usually you have to claim the horse before it's run. So if the horse breaks his leg during the middle of the race, you're screwed. You just bought a horse with a broken leg.
So it's sort of like gambling on horses today. You're guessing that which is the best horse.
Yeah, well, if you want a horse, it doesn't matter if you think it's best. If you want that horse, you can claim it.
Oh, yeah.
Make sense?
Yes.
In this claiming race, Seabiscuit finished second, but nobody claimed him. Throughout his two-year-old season, Seabiscuit was raced very frequently, which put a lot of strain on his underdeveloped legs, his muscles, his ligaments, and all of that stuff. Before he was 24 months old, he'd raced 13 times. His grandsire, Man of War, was only raced 21 times in his entire life. Seabiscuit lost every one of these races.
When the racing stables was moved to New Hampshire, Seabiscuit was raced again. This time, the jockey really didn't care, and he didn't even try and force Seabiscuit. He was just gonna run to lose him. Since Seabiscuit didn't feel forced, he was just a little bit ornery and won by 2 lengths. Seabiscuit was immediately entered into another claiming race with the hopes that this recent win by Seabiscuit would encourage someone to take the chance and buy him, and so they could get rid of him. Again, he wasn't forced, and again, he won, and he broke the track record. He still wasn't claimed. Seabiscuit continued a grueling racing schedule when he was allowed a 2-week break, partially due to the fact that he was breaking down. Once out of rest, he ran and broke another track record. In total, in his 2-year-old racing season, he ran 35 times. He had also been used as a training mate for other horses and forced to lose to give the other horses encouragement. This being forced to lose didn't discourage Seabiscuit. It just made him mad.
Now for a little horse anatomy. For anybody who does not know, this is a horse. When a horse is galloping, there is a time when the horse's entire weight is on one front leg. This is like 1,500 pounds on one leg. And this is a tremendous amount of strain for that leg. Which leg this is depends on which leg is leading. Since races are run counterclockwise, a horse must lead with his left leg, so his left leg comes out first, to maintain proper balance in the turns. With the amount of racing that Seabiscuit had done as such an immature colt, his left knee, which was already weak because of genetics from his mother, this left knee would surely have broken down if Seabiscuit hadn't been smart enough to figure out a trick. Seabiscuit figured out that he needed to switch leads during the straightaways. So on the turns, he'd lead out with his left leg. So that left leg would be the one with all of the strain coming out of that leap. On the straightaway coming out of the turn, he would take a leaping step and switch to leading with his right. So all of that weight is coming down on his right leg, saving his left leg for the turns. Nowadays, a lot of horses are trained to do that anyways because it does really save the legs. Because like I said, imagine 1,500 pounds of weight landing on one leg while you're running somewhere between 30 to 40 miles an hour. That's a lot of pressure.
Seabiscuit was put back into racing in April once Fitzsimmons was done using him as a training mate. Seabiscuit would run 10 times by the end of July on 5 different tracks in 4 states. On August 3rd, 1936, he was entered into another claiming race that, despite all odds, he won by 6 lengths. He still wasn't claimed that day, but it was a turning point for the colt, because in the stands that day were two men who would become very important in Seabiscuit's life. 1 week after the race, he was bought for $8,000 by Charles Howard.
Charles Howard, great name by the way, prompts to his parents for giving him such a great name. He was a wealthy Californian who made his fortune selling cars when a time when horses and buggies were on their way out. He'd originally been a bicycle repairman who took on the challenge of repairing cars. Why is it the people who were working with bicycles were the ones who continued with future technologies? Namely cars and airplanes. Here's looking at you, Wright brothers. He eventually gained the entire Buick franchise in San Francisco. Howard had a love of horses and was brought into the sport of kings by a friend. In 1935, he bought his first racehorses. He had a trainer, but he wanted the best trainer. He found Tom Smith.
Tom Smith was a quiet cowboy, a loner. In the 20s, he started working as a foreman, farrier, and training assistant working at a Wild West show. He took care of the needs of 54 horses at one time. He learned to patch up many overraced horses. It was probably a hard job, but Tom learned from his experiences. He could turn horses who were wrecks into winners. When the Depression happened, a lot of things changed. Shortly before meeting Charles Howard, he was training one horse which he owned, but couldn't find anyone else to train for, until Howard's friend informed Howard about Tom. He was hired almost immediately.
Now Seabiscuit had been bought by a new owner, Charles Howard. Seabiscuit went to Detroit with the Howard stables, where Tom started to work his magic on Seabiscuit. Tom knew the horse was in pain, frustrated, and exhausted, and that was probably where much of Seabiscuit's misbehavior was coming from, because he had really started to act a lot more like his father, Hardtack, and misbehaving. Another thing Tom noticed is Seabiscuit wasn't eating like he should be, and his nerves were an absolute mess. Seabiscuit's first workout with Tom was supposed to be an easy canter, but Seabiscuit decided to turn it into a runaway. Seabiscuit didn't want to be held back and just went off. Tom just let him run for 2 miles. Seabiscuit finally realized at the end of this 2-mile runaway that this isn't really fun, fighting against somebody who's not fighting back. So he figured, okay, it's tiresome. And he's like, okay, I'm gonna stop. And he behaved all the way back to his stall. And he also was very happy to eat a treat given to him by Tom. Through this, Seabiscuit had also learned that he was not going to be forced by his riders anymore. Tom also knew that some of his nerves could be fixed with a companion. He first tried a goat. It worked for a while. The companion did help Seabiscuit's nerves and his constant stall walking from those nerves, and it also helped him eat because he now had competition for his food. But Seabiscuit did not really like the goat, so Seabiscuit eventually decided he was going to get rid of the goat. He grabbed the goat in his mouth, gave her a good shaking, and dumped her outside of the stall where the groom could rescue her. Tom realized the goat wasn't going to work, so Tom got a lead pony named Pumpkin. Seabiscuit liked Pumpkin and let Pumpkin stay. Eventually, Seabiscuit would gain some other companions, including a stray dog and a small spider monkey. So they had a bit of a menagerie going in Seabiscuit's stall.
So Tom was able to take care of Seabiscuit's frustration and nerves. Now he had to fix Seabiscuit's pain. Tom created braces for Seabiscuit's legs to ease any strain on the limbs while standing around, as well as putting soothing liniment on his aching muscles. This helped to strengthen Seabiscuit's weakened and exhausted legs. This is where the third major person in Seabiscuit's life came in. Red Pollard. Johnny, or Red Pollard's family, had originally built and run a factory in Edmonton, Alberta. But it was lost in a flash flood, with the family just managing to save themselves. This left the family of nine bankrupt. Red discovered his love of horses when delivering groceries on a pony to help his family earn extra money. As he grew older, Red haunted the stables, hoping to trade labor for a chance to ride. He wanted to go to the racing circuit and learn to be a jockey, but his mother understandably protests. Mothers have something about their children going into dangerous situations. In 1925, they made a compromise and allowed Red to the track, but only with a trusty family member as friend and guardian. However, Red's guardian abandoned him at the racetrack. Red was only 15. Red survived on his own by riding in dangerous bush league races and as a prize fighter in the boxing ring. When he showed up at the Detroit racetrack with his agent, he learned about a trainer who might be in need of a jockey. The trainer's name was Tom Smith.
Tom worked on retraining Seabiscuit into racing form. He was taught that he needed to be in front of the other horses at the finish line. Seabiscuit learned where that finish line was and would on his own start running harder the closer he got to the finish line. He also constantly wanted to run right alongside the rail, which could, in a race, cause trouble. To help with this, Tom had Seabiscuit run with blinkers on so Seabiscuit could focus on the track directly ahead of him. Seabiscuit also hated starting gates, raising a huge ruckus whenever put into one. Tom would bring Seabiscuit out to the starting gate every morning and work on making Seabiscuit stand quietly in the stall. It took time, but eventually, Seabiscuit could stand quietly in the starting gate for up to 10 minutes. After only 2 weeks, Tom decided to run Seabiscuit in a race. They were still working through Seabiscuit's issues, but his zest for running was apparent, and Tom wanted to see what he could do, even if Seabiscuit didn't win. Seabiscuit didn't get a good position in the race and was up against one of the best fillies in the nation. Seabiscuit acted up in the race by decelerating quickly and dropping to the back of the pack. But Red asked Seabiscuit to get his mind back on the race, and Seabiscuit answered with an amazing drive. He finished fourth, but Tom saw that Seabiscuit had speed and courage.
Seabiscuit's next race also didn't fare extremely well, as he went extremely wide on the turn, which makes the race longer for the horse, and he hadn't learned to really answer the reins with precision yet. He was also blocked by traffic. Despite all this, Seabiscuit came in second. On September 7th came a change. It was the Governor's Handicap. It wasn't a big race overall, but it was a big deal in Detroit. Seabiscuit stayed close to the lead at first, then slipped through an opening on the rail and took the lead. Other horses fought to stay with him or catch up. It was a close race, but Seabiscuit triumphed, winning $4,290. Remember, Howard had bought him for $8,000. Before leaving Detroit, Seabiscuit also won the Hindry Handicap and won another $2,010. Howard's $8,000 purchase of Seabiscuit seemed to be paying off. Seabiscuit was finally understanding the game after about 50 races. There was a problem with Seabiscuit's training, though. Even though he was running better and understood what was wanted of him, he couldn't be run with other horses in training. He would beat the other Howard horses in such a way as to suck the joy of running right out of the other horses. One horse in the Howard stables that ran with Seabiscuit was Exhibit. They ran side by side for a while in training, but Seabiscuit looked Exhibit in the eye, challenging him, and Exhibit said, "Nope!" and abruptly pulled himself up. Some horses that Seabiscuit gave his evil eye would actually have to be straightened out after being beaten by Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit liked to taunt his opponents, but sometimes would get too focused on that and lose the needed momentum to keep ahead of late stretch drivers. So he would have to be kept on task and focused. His rider would have to remind him, "Nope, we gotta keep going, buddy."
2 months after Seabiscuit left New York in the Howard train car as a beat-up outcast, he returned to run in one of the richest races of the fall season, the Scarsdale Handicap. He was still ridiculed by the people around the track, and the audience was not impressed when he came out on the track. Remember, he's not a good looker. Plus, the audience still remembered him when he was an absolute loser. So there was some reason why they didn't like him. They changed their tune in under 2 minutes. He won. Next, they were off to Howard's home state of California for the racing season there. And the San Francisco folks were very excited about Seabiscuit. His first race there was on November 28, 1936. Tom had been doing his training with Seabiscuit kind of in secret. He didn't like being around other trainers, so trained him at Tanforan track instead of the Bay Meadows race track where Seabiscuit would run. It could have also been that he didn't want to show off how good of a horse he had. The day of the race, Seabiscuit nonchalantly went out onto the track. During the race, he got stuck behind a wall of horses and had to go incredibly wide on the turn to keep up with the horses. Normally, horses have only one sprint drive in them. But, at least in this race, Seabiscuit had two, as he gave another sprint drive up the home stretch, winning by a length. After another victory at Bay Meadows, he was off to Santa Anita. He had trouble there and didn't race for a while. Even training was stalled to several issues. a lot of it due to poor weather. Seabiscuit also started plumping up a little bit due to his idleness. But idleness was not the only problem. Seabiscuit's groom liked to give him a lot of treats. And Seabiscuit had a sweet tooth. Just like me, he liked his treats. Mrs. Howard was the only one able to put a stop to that. And Seabiscuit was slowly put back into racing shape.
Seabiscuit finally ran on February 9th, 1937. He won! And next was the treasured $100,000 Santa Anita Handicap on February 27th, 1937. The Seabiscuit family was excited, sure he would win. The racing fans, not so much because of rumors of Seabiscuit's unsoundness, as they hadn't seen him training because of Tom's secretive training. In the race, Seabiscuit came to the lead and held. But then a late closer, Rosemont, slowly began creeping up. It was then a mistake was made. Red and Seabiscuit lost focus, and Rosemont came up to win by a nose in a photo finish. What exactly the reason for this loss can never be 100% nailed down for sure. It could have been overconfidence on the part of the jockey and the horse, poor footing along the rail, because if you remember, Seabiscuit really liked running along the rail, the fact that Red was actually blind in his right eye. And this was something that he really tried to keep secret, because this is something that could have ended his racing career. And it could have been a combination of those, or something that I was not able to discover in my research. It even could have been a bit of all of the above. Tom and Howard, however, didn't drop Red from riding Seabiscuit, and they didn't blame him. Most jockeys in those days, if they lost a big race, they'd have been out the door, never riding for that trainer and owner again. But Red stayed on Seabiscuit. Despite the loss, they moved forward toward Seabiscuit's next race.
Well, that's going to have to be it for today. This is the first part of our series on Seabiscuit and also War Admiral.
So stay tuned till next time till we upload our next video, whenever the heck we do that.
So, until our next adventure, see you later.